Point number four says, Satan was bound at the beginning of Christ's reign. And our texts there are Matthew 12:29, Luke 4:18, Ephesians 4:8-10, Judges 5:12, Galatians 4:22-25, Ezekiel chapter 22 verse 25. Now, Satan was bound at the beginning of Christ's reign, and this is very significant and very important. Now, we learned last week that the gospel, the angel that came down in Revelation chapter 20 verse 1 represented the angel that had the chain and the key. Remember, he used the chain to bind the devil, okay, from deceiving the nations. Now, that represented the Holy Spirit-empowered gospel, which came down from heaven beginning on the day of Pentecost. Now, we said our reference for that was Matthew 16:18-19, where Peter was told by Jesus that he would be given the keys to the kingdom and he would be able to bind, okay, on earth. So there Peter was given the keys and the chain, right? So that those keys and that chain represented the same thing that the angel in Revelation 20 did, okay? The keys were to open or set free, and the chain was to bind. The key was to loose and the chain was to bind, okay? So we saw last week that what was being loosed were those who were in deception, and what was being bound was the deceiver, or that which was deceiving, right? So now Christ, the point that we are going to make here is that Satan had to be bound at the beginning of Christ's reign. That is, at the time when that gospel began preaching on the day of Pentecost. That was the time that Satan was bound. But modern Christianity tells us that the binding of Satan is yet future. All right? So what are they actually saying? When your concept is that the binding of Satan is yet future, the binding of deception is yet future, it means to say that deception in your case, deception is rampant, is loosed. Because it's also saying that the gospel that the modern church preaches has no power. It cannot bind, nor can it liberate. Because you're saying that the binding of Revelation 20 verse 1 is still yet future, which means your gospel is powerless. That's what they're saying. But let's look at what Christ said. And we looked at this text last week, Matthew chapter 12 verse 29. Let's go to our Bible, Matthew chapter 12 verse 29. All right, so here is where we, you know, in some of these studies, we are now beginning to put two and two together and come to some real eye-opening conclusions and realizations. Matthew chapter 12, verse 29, we looked at this last week, but look what Christ said. Verse 28 begin, but if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, or the power of God, right, then the kingdom of God is come to you. Or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the strong man? Okay, so Jesus is clearly saying here that in order to set or to begin his battle with the strong man, to enter the strong man's territory and to take the prisoners from the strong man's territory and set free those who were captive in the strong man's house, you first have to bind the strong man. So you cannot say that Christ began reigning and has not yet bound the strong man. Look at what Christ said in Luke chapter 4 verse 18. In Luke chapter 4 verse 18, Christ went into the synagogue and he took up the scroll of the prophet Isaiah and he began to read. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor," preach the good news to the poor. "He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance." Now this is one of the key. This is one of the things the key would do. Right? This is one of the key things the key would do. Deliverance to the captives. It would set the captives free. That's what the key of the gospel does. Right? And recovering of sight to the blind. To set at liberty, to set free. Again, another property of the key. To open the prison house of them that are bruised. Okay? So Christ is clearly saying here that his ministry, not just the ministry that he had on earth as the Son of Man, but when he returned to heaven and became and received back his omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence, where he can return in the spirit and where he can accompany that gospel of truth which comes from heaven with the chain and with the key, right? At that time, it would bind the deceiver and the deception. It makes no sense to wait until the end of everything to bind deception. You have to bind deception in order for people, in order for people's eyes to be opened, recovering of the sight of the blind. And Jesus was not speaking here of the natural blindness. He was talking about the spiritual blindness. The miracles that Jesus did of opening the eyes, the natural eyesight, and so on, they were signs. If you read the book of John, it says they were signs. And a sign is something that points to a greater. Okay? The sign points to the greater, whether it's a spiritual reality or something coming in the future. Okay? So there were signs. So the physical blindness being healed was pointing to the spiritual blindness being healed. And for that to happen, that angel had to come down with the key and with the chain. And for that to happen, it had to happen at the beginning. So once that devil, that deception was bound, then people could be set free. But the Christian church teaching today that the devil has not yet been bound, based on their understanding, their flesh understanding, right? They're saying deductions. A conclusion based on a flesh understanding of what Christ was saying and what the revelation is teaching. So they are saying, oh, we have in earthquakes, we have in volcanoes, we have in tsunamis. So the devil has not been bound in there. That's how they're looking at the devil, as being in charge of earthquakes and natural disasters. Oh, there is people still killing one another. There's still violence and crime. So they're looking at the devil as responsible for that. Right? What Christ was talking about was the binding of deception. And so he says his ministry would deliver the captives and set them at liberty, set them free. Now look at Ephesians chapter 4, which tells you when this began. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 8. Okay, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. It says there, speaking of Christ, it says, now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Notice Christ had to become spirit. That's how he can fill all. He can't fill all in his human body. That's why Christ says, he told his disciples, it was necessary for him to leave, to go back to his Father. Because when he went back to his Father, there he can receive his omnipresence. There's where he can become spirit, right? And then when as spirit, he can fill all things, right? Now it says, and he gave some apostles. So when he came now, when he came back, filling all things as the Spirit, is when he began to give the gifts of the Spirit. So he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, and so on, right? So Christ had to come in the Spirit as that angel which comes down from heaven, accompanying the Holy Spirit empowered. That gospel was Christ himself in the Spirit with the binding and the setting free, the chain and the key. All right? So that chain, as I said, would bind the deception, as Revelation 20 verse 1 and 2 says. And the setting free was the key. All right? So let's continue reading. In Ephesians chapter 4, look at verse 8. It says, why he said when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive. Okay? When Christ ascended, that's when he went on the throne, and that's when he received, according to Acts chapter 2, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit, meaning that he himself became omnipresent. He himself returned to his spirit form, which was the form of God, which he had before, according to Philippians 2. Right? And in that form, he now was able to do the very thing which he said in Isaiah 60. Set at liberty the captives. And so it says at that time, the freeing of the captives began. Now this term captivity captive, it's a Hebrew saying wherein after ancient Israel was victorious in a battle, they had taken captives of the enemy nation. Most times it was the strong young men and the virgins and the children, because these were human resources that could build that the nation of Israel, or whichever nation was victorious. They would take the strong young men, the intelligent ones, those who did not die in the battle, right? Like, for example, when Babylon conquered Jerusalem, you remember Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They were captives carried over into Babylon because of their high intellect. So Babylon valued persons of intellect because they realized they could take these people and put them in position of power where they could manage the affairs of Babylon and be under the king and so on, right? But they were captives. They were Jewish captives, okay? So the same in Israel, when Israel conquered, or any victorious nation, but we're looking in the context of Israel, when Israel conquered an enemy nation, they would have the prisoners of war, okay? And they would have them in a long line, march them over into Israel. And that, these captives were like the trophies of war to show off to the welcoming party at home. And the welcoming party were mostly the women and the young women who did not go to war. So when the warriors and so on came with these prisoners of war, the women would sing praises. Okay? We have, like, for example, if we go to Judges chapter 5, verse 12. Okay, we'll see this, right? Judges chapter 5, verse 12. It says there, Judges chapter 5, verse 12. Right? It says there, "Awake, awake, Deborah." Now, Deborah was a judge in Israel. She was probably the only female judge. And her general, the person who led her army, was Barak. So after they had gained the victory in this battle, it says, "Awake, awake, Deborah. Awake, awake, utter a song." You see, this is the welcoming song, the song when they entered into the Israel after the victory with all of these captives behind in the long line. Right? The welcoming song, would be victory song, the women would sing it, right? And it says, "Arise, Barak." Barak was the general of the army. "And lead your captivity captive." Right? So it's a battle term of when a conquering general goes and conquers the enemy nation and takes prisoner those who were in that nation and brings them over into Israel. Now look at the spiritual application of that. For Christ to have ascended with captives means that he first had to bind the strong man of that enemy nation, spiritually speaking, which was the devil. Right? So the binding of Satan had to be done at the time of Christ's ascension. Good? When the Holy Spirit was poured out with that key and that chain. Good? Then the captives would now be able to be set free. The captivity captive. They would now be able to be set free and brought over from the enemy camp into the victor's camp, which is Christ's kingdom. Right? You remember the scripture says that we were enemies of God. Romans chapter 8. It says we were enemies of God. But in Christ we are his friends. Right? So we have been moved from the enemy camp, the kingdom of darkness, into the kingdom of light. And it is all through the power of the gospel. Because Romans chapter 1 tells us, "I am not afraid of the power of the gospel." I'm not afraid of the gospel, sorry. It is the power of God. Right? It's the power of God to bind and to loose. That's all that Revelation 20. The binding of Satan. That's all that is inside those verses, right? Leading captivity captives. So in the case of Christ, he first had to bind the devil, i.e. bind deception. To lead Satan's captives out from deception. And the point of this is that this deception must have necessity been bound at the beginning, when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost. It would not make any sense to bind Satan at the end of everything, or to bind deception at the end of everything. But this is precisely what modern Christianity is telling us. They are of the opinion that Satan has not yet been bound. Thus, they are testifying of the powerlessness of their gospel. Christ clearly said that the first thing he would do, not the last thing, the first thing he would do was to bind the strong man so that he could take his spoils. In the time of Moses, God had to bind Satan, bind Pharaoh. God had to bind Pharaoh first. If he did not bind Pharaoh first, the people, which were the Israelites in bondage, would not have been let go. God first had to bind Pharaoh. All those plagues and the death of the firstborn of Egypt were what bound Pharaoh and caused him to let the people go. So when Moses and Israel left Egypt, Moses was leading captivity captive out of Egypt. And that was an allegory of Jesus, because you remember, Jesus was the new Moses. Okay? Jesus, that was an allegory now of Jesus leading the remnant out of bondage to the old covenant. Right? Paul in Galatians chapter 4, 22 tells us that the old covenant had become a system of bondage, and he called it Egypt. So the old covenant now, when the covenant of the Spirit came in, it was such that it was so superior to the Sinai covenant that the Sinai covenant now had become a form of bondage, because the leaders of that ministration were preventing people from going into the Spirit covenant, just like Pharaoh was preventing Israel from going into the Sinai covenant. Right? So Jesus had to bind that which was the accuser and adversary of God's people, of God's remnant. He had to bind that which accused them before God and which was contrary to them. He bound that adversary by the word of truth, the gospel which came down with the Holy Spirit. And it was Israel's leaders and high priests who were ministers of the strong man, of that system of bondage, which God was about to bring to an end. These were the visible Satan, which went about like a roaring lion seeking to devour the remnant. Remember, Revelation was written in the context of John's time. Okay? Today we talk about, oh yeah, the devil is going about like a roaring lion. That was not the context. The context of Revelation was not 21st century. It wasn't 20th century. It wasn't even 18th, 19th, nor 15th century. It was the time of John. And the roaring lion that was going about in John's time was Israel. The leaders of Israel. You remember Paul was one of them. Saul of Tarsus. He was one of them. He got letters from the high priest to seek to go about to throw the remnant in jail. To jail them and even kill them. Stephen was killed as the first martyr, right? So they were going about like the roaring lion because they know that their time was short. By the way, Ezekiel chapter 22, 25 talks about this roaring lion. Huh? So let's go look at it. Ezekiel 22, verse 25. All right. Ezekiel 22. 25. All right. And I know you never heard it like this anywhere. Okay. Look at what God said through Ezekiel. He says, there is a conspiracy of her prophets, and these are the prophets of Israel. He said, there is a conspiracy of her prophets in the middle thereof, like a roaring lion. Ravening the prey, they have devoured souls. Right? This was a reference to the prophets and the leaders of Israel. That roaring lion reference. So when the Revelation talked about roaring lions, Israel knew what they were talking about. The remnant knew what it was speaking of. Good? So their time was short, because remember, Christ had already told them that God would take the kingdom from them and give it to another nation. And that was precisely what was happening. God was taking the kingdom from Israel and giving it to the remnant. And that was happening during the time of the book of Acts, during the epistles of Paul, during the book of Revelation, all in the time of John. Okay? So it was their system and their authority that was cast out of heaven. You know what I mean? The devil was cast out of heaven, has come down to you having great wrath, because he knew that he had but a short time. It was speaking of these people and their system and the old covenant system. That was what was being removed. That system, that kingdom was being removed and being replaced with the kingdom of Christ. Heaven represented their place of authority over Israel in the temple, where they sat in Moses' seat. Right? Thus, the binding of Revelation 20 verse 1 must have occurred at the beginning of the preaching of the Holy Spirit empowered gospel, for it was necessary to first bind the strong man before the captives could be set free.